Y'all know who this is. Of course, the whole Greece, the whole Chicago Heights, whole South Suburbs know who this individual is. This that nigga, that former governor of the Gangsta Disciple organization, Abadell, clerk. Of course, he one of the main motherfuckers who brought Gangsta Disciple to the Greasy. Abadell, what can you say to my viewers about the history of the Black Gangsta Disciple organization and your experience?
First things first, to the Islamic Ummah, the Kushi Ummah, the Jinji Ummah, and the rest that might fall into the category of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Yes indeed, first things first. The organization was formed in the 70s. It started with Larry Hoover. Larry Hoover was a High Supreme gangster. David Barksdale was a devil disciple. They used to be adversaries, but they see that there was two kings of all kings and couldn't nobody touch their status, so they united, collaborated this organization into one function. The Black Gangsta Disciples is where it all started at. I was only 13 years old when I first became a Black Gangsta Disciple. There it is right there. BGD. The Gangsta Disciples originated from Black Gangsta Disciples. That's our original pitch force. So, what it was, after Larry and King David, the king of all kings, saw that they couldn't be adversaries no longer because there was two of a kind, Larry said, well, David, I'm always be a gangster no matter what. David said, well, Larry, I'm always be a disciple. I'm devil disciple, you have supreme gangster. So what we're gonna do with this organization, we're gonna be gangster disciples, but Black gangster disciples. So the organization unified, and the Black Gangsta Disciples organization emerged. So after that founded, we had an organizational movement with the Black gangsters, who are today known as Breed, Boone Black the leader. The devil disciples, the High Supreme Gangsters became Black Gangsta Disciples. The Black gangsters are Breed today. And then we had the Black disciples, King Shorty, may his soul rest in peace. So that was one organizational function. Until the concept emerged, when David Barksdale died, may his soul rest in peace, when he succumbed, Larry Hoover became the king of all kings of the disciples. But we always had the Latin folks. They was always our organizational family, our first cousins. The Latin Spanish gangsters, the Cobras, you know, all of these original
Maniac Latin Disciples,
all of them was always, all Latino folks was always our family, including the Simon City Royals. They was a part of the Latin category. And we was associated with the Mad Black Souls, the Gangsters of Souls. All of them was, we was all as one with them in the 80s until the concept emerged. And when the concept emerged, then Larry went his way, and then it just became Latin folks and the Gangsta Disciples. That's where it all came from. And so I was only 13 years old when I became a Black Gangsta Disciple. I came to Ford Heights, which was known at that particular time as East Chicago Heights. And when I first came out here, there was no organizations, but in Chicago Heights, which was known as the Northern Player. The Northern Player leaders was Duck Montgomery and Paper Bag Montgomery, Donald Montgomery, and Orlando Montgomery. They was ahead of the Northern Player. We used to war with those guys. We used to war with them. My first recruit in Ford Heights, there was East Chicago Heights at that particular time, was Andrew Hardy, known as Pinocchio. Me and Pinocchio was the first Black Gangsta Disciples in Ford Heights. We started with Lexington Circle. Then came Goldie Mike, his brother Kobe. We recruited them. Then Gene Bentley, Matt Goins, and Wolf, they were the brothers. And then Leroy Stevenson and his brother, Craig Hatton. Craig Hatton was one of the first Black Gangsta Disciples, of the original Black Gangsta Disciples that started in the Circle. We used to war with the Northern Players. The Northern Players was very feared by the entire society of the suburbs because they was ruthless. And they was known as ruthless killers. But when we fought them for so long, when they converted to Black Gangsta Disciples, it was in the Stars and Publications newspaper in Chicago Heights. They said, it indicated, quote unquote, the Northern Players has not converted but graduated, they said. The Northern Players has graduated from Northern Players to Black Gangsta Disciples. Bam. After that, the mob really blew up in the suburbs. The Northern Players and Black Gangsta Disciples, now they hit the whole Chicago Heights, like even the west side of Chicago Heights. And then I hit Ford Heights, the Easy Greasy. After that, shortly after that, I had a problem. I caught my first murder when I was 14, going on 15, on Buckingham. He died, but they brought him back to life. I went to Ali home, I stayed a week, I beat that out because he was in his 20s, and I was only 14, so they made it look like self-defense. So it was the inevitable that they had to let me go, even though the state prosecutors tried to have me indicted and prosecuted on that case. After that, I did some other things on the streets, and my name blew up. I started selling big time weed. The biggest weed dealers out here was KD and Red, Frank Smith, my daddy. And I was selling big time weed for them Pinky Best. You know, they was big time weed dealers out here. Cocaine was always around, but it hadn't surfaced on the land where everybody was selling packs. And it started with pony packs. So to make a long story short, the Black Gangster Cypher started from there. When I was 17, I went to the penitentiary. I was 17 years old. That's when I first came across the personal of claiming. I reiterate, I was only 17 years old when I first went to the penitentiary, and I personally came across the acquaintance of Larry Hoover. Can't know anybody walk up to him. He was always on, he was in Stateville, and he was a leader of the basketball squad out there. He happened to be coming through Joliet. When I first went through I was at Joliet intake, and I went to the gym, me and Face, who's deceased from the Jeffrey Manor, me, Face, and Baby C, we was all governors, but before he was governor, we was just outstanding members. Only 17 years old I was, and we saw Larry personally. We forced our way to the gym, the lieutenant right there in Joliet. What y'all doing coming from the West Cell House? We come to see Larry Hoover, my man. And that was considered a necessity for us to see him. Even if we have to suffer the consequences of going to say it, we're going to do this. We want to see our chief. He bagged up and let us in because Larry had some guys from Stateville with him on security. I was only 17, my first arriving in the penitentiary was Joliet. So we went in the gym, Larry saw us, his security allowed us to walk up to him. He was sitting down with his legs crossed while his guys from Stateville was warming up, preparing for a game against Joliet basketball team. He saw me, he called me to the side, I acquainted myself with him, I had a deep conversation with him, I trusted the course of my conversation confirms why I stand intellectually, so I always had the gift of gab, even when I was a kid. But Larry was like, man, you very shy with your vocabulary, and you got heart. He knew I was new to martial arts and everything, and he told me, he said, you know what I'm going to do? He said, he conversed with a couple of other guys, Face and C, and he said, AD, he said, I'm going to give you Joliet. You're going to run the whole Joliet penitentiary. I go, no, I want to come to Stateville with you. He go, no, everybody want to come where I'm at. I'm cheap. I say, I'm going to give you the whole Joliet Correctional Center. I go, okay. But later, before the game was over, he had talked to Face and see. Face, everybody know Face from Menard. You know, he ran the entire Menard Correctional Center, and then he became a BM. He went to the streets, and shortly after his arrival back to society, something happened. I don't know exactly what transpired, but I certainly know with certainty, I definitely know that it was the organization that did that to him, but he wound up being assassinated. But anyway, Face and C was real smart. They was in data entry, and they had certificates, you know, certifying what they do in a data entry. So Chief changed his mind. He called me back to the table and said, no, I'm going to give Face and C the whole joint. He said, I'm going to give Face and C the whole institution, AD. He said, but you gonna run the whole cell house, but they the whole they, Face is the head man of all man, and then C followed behind him. I don't know why he did that. Face and C vocabulary wasn't equivalent to mine, but they had that certification. I wasn't even, I was 17 years old. I got kicked out of Broome Trail when I was 16 because they caught me with some weed. I was selling weed in the school, and I had a banger. So they didn't call the police. They just suspended me for a whole year. And in the process of that whole year, I wound up never going back because I caught this case. And I'm describing and explaining to you about right now with the Larry Hoover situation. But anyway, Larry Hoover gave Face the whole institution, the whole compound, and Steve was his assistant, and they gave me the sale house, the big sale house. So my nigga that was assisting me was Pookie Slim, Ron Williams. We ran the whole institution for Face and Lil C. And I did this for years before I got sent to Sheridan. From Sheridan, I got kicked out, I went to Stateville. Larry started mingling with me. We got more and more acquainted. I came to the street. I was the reason. Started dealing with my guy, Governor Vic, from the Wild Wild Hunt. I stayed in the hunt. Me and Vic got totally acquainted. But I met Vic in Stateville. I met Vic in Joliet. He had just came through, but he didn't stay for no longer than 3 months. He was on the rich. For some reason, he disappeared, and he came back to the street. And so Vic became a governor. When I came to the streets, he was already a governor. Me and Vic, we united with Gerard Hardy. We made Gerard a region. I was already a region. As time moved along, like maybe a year and a half after that, me and Vic ran the whole hundreds. The whole hundred. Vic always was the man, but certain organization memos were saying that Vic was extorting folks, setting certain folks up, getting robbed, the guy that was rolling Vic weight. So I cleared Vic's name. I united the organizational membership when Vic called the big session in the Wild Wild Hunters. The whole Wild Wild Hunters was there as Jeff Carwash, I believe it was on 109th somewhere, but Jeff, Big Jeff had a car wash out there. And Vic told me he knew I was the spokesman. I was always the spokesman and the leader, but I was only a region at this time. So Vic was like, yeah, this AD from the suburbs, but he's from the Wild Wild 100, but he moved out here. Here's the situation. AD gonna address y'all about, to clear my name of this negative, erroneous information y'all had about me extorting the folks. And I took this, I took the flow, and I told the guy, ain't no big meat to use in this mile, it have never been. Larry Hoover personally said, every standing member, regardless of what his title pertains to, deserve a fair shake. Even if he fuck up for the first time, excuse my profanity, I just couldn't find other words better to express myself. Larry said, even if he fuck up, still give him the benefit of the doubt. Don't always go into banging a nigga head against the wall, giving him punching here. So, we had to give these guys the benefit of the doubt, because even if he had an outstanding title, ain't no big meat to use, law govern all events. So if a head do something out of the guidelines, then he got a consequence, he got something, it's gonna be more tremendous than the one than the standing member that slipped up, because he a leader. And he know his obligations to his responsibilities to that title. So anyway, I took the flow and I told the guys in the 100, I said, you know, we all got a responsibility to individually live up to the expectations of law govern all events. Mr. Larry Hoover knew that when he organized his organization and the concept emerged, he knew that he couldn't personally have the opportunity to acquaint himself with the entire membership, even though we was worldwide. He knew he couldn't do this because of his confinement. So he said, my way of introducing myself to this organization for those that want to be a part of it is through the concept. The creed, the players we, the players out, the presentation, the common sense approach, the preface dialogue, all these different isolated units that serve as a whole and what this whole concept pertain to. Larry said, if you about me on the streets, wherever you're at, China, Beirut, I don't care what you are, that's why we dropped the beat. Larry said, we ain't gonna make it a black movement no more. I don't care what you are, if you're from Vietnam, if you're from Arabia, wherever you from, if you want to be a gangster disciple and you got that G in you, then it ain't a black movement no more. That's why we dropped the beat and became gangster disciples, to unify every race that had G in them, to stand on the organization function as a standing member by those means. So I let the guys know that we all got a responsibility to live up to the expectations that we're ordained to do this if you're a standing member to this function. And so I let the guys know that Larry didn't have the opportunity because of his incarceration to acquaint himself with the entire membership. So that's the documentation, the concept. If you're about Larry Hoover, you will study your laws and policies so that if you are a part of a leadership that might be covertly moving against the organization through means of dissension, then you would know his limitations by trying to address this man, showing him his leadership respect because you're a subordinate of his. And if that don't work, then you take it to the chain of command, the next man behind it, and he take it to his staff until they bring it to the table and find a way to solutionize the problem. But that's what law pertains to. I went over to the details about this so that you can know the extent of what organizations, laws, and policies pertain to. Regardless of what y'all doing today, renegading, whatever, still know your shit, because when you go to the jails, they ain't having it. You might can do it on the street, but when you enter them institutions, including the county jail, and you don't know what, you don't know nothing about what organizations pertain to, and laws and policies, documentation, then you got yourself a problem. So the more you know, the better you are. It ain't who you know.
It's
what you know, my man. It's what you know, and what you know pertains to this organization. So I'm giving you the history where this gangster disciple, black gangster disciple organization thing derived from. King David, who will always be king of all kings, and Larry Hoover, High Supreme Gangster Larry Hoover, King David, devil disciple. So what's understood and not to be explained, our history ain't no mystery. So as I dealt with Vic and his guys, got acquainted with me, they fell in love with the way I articulated my thoughts and how I addressed that particular issue pertaining to the concept, to the membership. Before I know it, we blew up in the dope game. I was always big in the dope game in Fort Heights. I wanted to expand my horizon, so I went to the Otter B. Wells, 35th and Rose. And I had some issues with some guys out there claiming to be, well, they was a part of the membership, but they didn't have the organization work. It was Bookie, Mookie, and Cliff. Bookie had to customize Candy Alpharetta Seville with the gold rims. Everybody remember Boogie. And when Mookie had the Astro Bands, and Cliff was just a runner, all he had was a drop top Z24 with no rims. They had Cliff running that area. And the Wallaby Wells was banging, I must admit. They was getting dizzy out, you know what I'm saying? And so I stepped on the scene, and I saw that Cliff wasn't taking care of his business like he's supposed to. So I stepped on his toes. I moved along. I had a situation with Cliff, who was working for Mookie and Boots. He went through the region of that area. Sure, me and CB and Vic, we had did some things short of G before he became a BM that the feds got right now. we always good. They was all governors, but I was the reason at that time. So I war with them niggas on that spot. I wasn't running from nothing. I took some of my men with me from the 100s. TC short for Too Cold. Me, TC, for Morgan Park, and a couple of us, we went out there and took over. I didn't want to involve Vic, even though everybody knew Vic and AD. Everybody knew who Vic and AD was in the organization. We used to deal with Muscle G, Les, the governor that the Bogus Boys killed from 47 to Vincennes. Les was the governor in that particular area. Leslie Brown, also known as Muscle G. He was the man for the area. So when the Bogus Boys killed Les, then Vic was running that area too, because Vic got kids by Les' sister, Gloria Brown. I was dealing with his sister, Can-Can, Juanita Brown. So I didn't want to take Vic to the Ivy Well, because Vic was preoccupied in the 100s. So I know I'm AD. I know I can stand my own ground. I knew I had the ability to intellectually capitalize on anything I want to. I'm deep into the martial arts. I don't talk the talk. I walk the walk. So I'm not trying to impress nobody. I want y'all to know who AD is. I was there. My history ain't no mystery. Every nigga knew I was always a vegetarian. I've been a vegetarian since I was 16. And not only that, my reputation is known for knocking niggas' teeth out of the mouth, because I do martial arts. Thank you.